Amen. Thank you, Jim. Good morning, church, and a happy Father's Day to all. It's a good day and a wonderful opportunity to remember our fathers and to celebrate the roles that they have played in our lives. I want to thank DeLynn for this wonderful and beautiful display. I see a bunch of different things here that traditionally represent fathers. I see a lot of tools except for duct tape, which is generally my favorite tool, but it's beautiful. And right here you'll see hope written with this extension cord, and that is our theme for this week. And it's good to be able to preach to all of you from the sanctuary again as well. Although I do miss seeing all of your faces, and I know you miss seeing each other's faces as well. So we invite you to a virtual coffee hour following the service. Like last week, all you have to do is to click on the link that was provided to you. You don't need an account to join in. You can either do it through the web browser or through the app itself, but we hope to be able to see you then. Also, beginning on July 1st, we will hold the first of our four Prayer in the Grove gatherings. Now, these are going to be times for us to be able to gather together and focus on prayer. Outside in the Grove, we're going to have music, special guest speakers, and opportunities to pray for each other, for our community, and for the world. For the first gathering, we have invited Brett Saunders to discuss the topic of racism. So bring your lawn chairs and your blankets. Don't forget your mask, and make plans to join us on Wednesday, July 1st at 7 p.m. As I mentioned before, today we continue our three-week series on hope. We'll take time to be reminded that we can always count on the faithfulness of God. So to prepare our hearts for that, let's join together in our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. blessings all mine, with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Here at church, I'm really excited to share with you a quick message. And today is Father's Day, isn't that cool? So you get to say Happy Father's Day to your dad, to your grandpa, to your uncles maybe, to any father figure in your family. Cool, do you get him a gift? Wasn't socks, was it? Well, if you did get him socks, don't worry. I'm sure, you know, he cares more about the time with you than the gifts, but you know, for next year, okay? Today, I want to share with you, how do you say father in different languages? And for the first one, I want to invite a friend of mine, a guest. And you might know him. His name is Pedro. Okay, let's welcome him. Pedro. Welcome, Pedro. A lot of people think that we are the same person. Isn't that crazy?
Thank you. Yeah, it's crazy that people think we're the same person. That's funny. Anyways, I'm always really, really happy to be here at UMCL, so thank you for inviting me again and to be with you. But I'm really excited to share with you how do you say father in Spanish, all right? Are you ready? All right. You say padre. Repeat with me. Padre. Very good. You guys are so good. Also, you can say papi. Okay, that's an informal way. It's like saying daddy. Okay, papi. You guys are awesome. All right, I need to go right now because I need to keep opening my present, which I'm sure it's going to be socks again, like every single year. But I don't mind. I love my socks. All right? All right, bye. Bye.
Bye, Pedro. Oh, he's always so funny. Anyways. Always good to see Pedro here. Great. So now I want to invite my daughter, another guest, Tea, join me. Tea's going to help me teach you guys more languages. How do you say father in different languages? So are you ready for the next one? So here's how you say father in German. Okay, are you ready? In German, you say Vater.
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 Very good. It's kind of similar, right? It's not too hard. Are you ready for a really hard one? Yeah? Chinese.
Chinese.
Very good. Hold it there. And now here's how you say father in Chinese. You say Fujin.
Fujin.
Fujin. There you go. Thank you very much. Yeah, throw it there. All right, you can go with mommy now. Thank you. Thank you, Tea. You were great. But my favorite one is what Jesus used to call his dad. His heavenly father, Abba. And actually, Jesus and Apostle Paul used the word Abba, father, to call on God. And Abba actually means like dear daddy, and such an intimate word. And you know why they used to do that? Because, for example, when you're calling your dad, right, you say, Dad, I'm hungry. You don't say, Father, I'm hungry, I need some food. No, you say, Daddy, I'm hungry, please, can I have some food, right? Because you have a relationship, you have an intimate relationship, and you know your dad cares for you. Or when, for example, my daughter Tea is scared or is having a nightmare or something, she normally says, Daddy, Daddy. Well, actually, she says, Mommy. But we're working on that, doesn't matter. But it's that relationship that unites us, that helps us come closer. And she knows I care for her. I want the best for her. And it's the same with God. Our Heavenly Father wants the best for you. So now you know, whenever you're feeling sad, you're feeling lonely, or you're having a bad day, or even a good day, you're feeling happy, you can come to God and say, Abba, Father, dear Daddy in heaven, I want to ask you to help me. I want to ask you to be with me today. Thank you for my family. So today you get to celebrate your peer, your dad, your grandpa, your uncles, but also the love of God. Okay? So go and keep celebrating Father's Day with your family. Thank you.
Not a city of angels, but we can build a city for all. We may not reach the ending, but we can start slowly but truly mending. Brick by brick, heart by heart, now, maybe now, we start learning how we can build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but we can build a city for all. When your trust is all but shattered, when your faith is all but killed, you can give up bitter and battered, or you can slowly start to build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but finally a city for all. A city for all.
Happy Father's Day. As we pray together today, we're especially grateful for our fathers and father figures, and we ask God to bless them or bless our memories of them. And we ask that He will comfort and surround those for whom this is a difficult or complicated day. So will you join with me? Dear Heavenly Father, as we join together in prayer, we offer the joys and concerns of our own hearts, and we lift up the following requests from our church family. We pray for the Kuhlman's college friend who suffered a stroke, as well as for her caregivers, John and David, And in gratitude for the life of Grandpa Joe, may his wife and family feel surrounded by your peace. We join with Bina in offering healing prayers for her niece Isabella. Lord, please guide the medical team and comfort Isabella and her family. We're grateful for the ministries and friendship of Bob and Jean Kowal. Father, continue to bless them as they settle into their new home and community. Lord, we ask that your hand be on Marguerite Mason. Comfort her as she undergoes hip surgery. Grant her healing and peace. Lead the medical team. Grant them wisdom and discernment as she recovers. Father, we thank you for your presence with Kara's dad during his recent surgery, and we ask you to continue to surround Joyce and Woody. Grant him healing and peace. Lord, be with Debbie Williams' sister-in-law as she again battles cancer. Give her strength. May she feel your comfort and healing. We thank you for the life of our sister, Tess Wojcik. Comfort her family, Father, as they grieve her loss. Lord, we ask you to help us to be instruments of your peace in this time of challenge and change. We pray for our leaders in government, community, and churches. Grant them wisdom. Grant us all loving hearts. Help us to see you in all people, to reflect you to all people. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Peggy. So a shipwrecked sailor had spent several years stuck on a deserted island, completely alone. Now he learned how to survive on the island. Actually, the island was quite beautiful, and he was quite an optimist. And he took the best the island had to give him, built himself a nice shack. But being an optimist, every single day he walked down the shore of the island to see if anyone would come rescue him. Then one morning he was thrilled to see a ship offshore and a small vessel coming off it towards him. When the boat grounded on the beach, the sailor was a little confused because the boat only had room for one person. And the officer in charge coming off the vessel didn't really look all that happy to find him either. And instead of greeting him with a hug or with a handshake, he handed the sailor a bunch of newspapers. And he said, "We have a new policy when it comes to rescuing people. Before we take you back, the captain wants you to read these newspapers and let us know if you still want to be rescued." I think many of us can relate to that story. Many of us feel stuck on an island by ourselves right now. But even the idea of moving from where we are seems daunting. Everywhere we look, there seems to be bad news. And even if you see yourself generally as an optimist, you may have had a rough going as of late. Between the pandemic and all of its ramifications, the political division that we have been experiencing in this country for a while now, and now, more recently, another instance of racism that brings to light a lot of systematic oppression that may have been going unnoticed for some of us. And on top of this, many of us may be going through our own personal struggles. So it almost feels like we're stuck in our situations, stuck in our anger and frustration, stuck in our fear, stuck in our despair. And even if you are an optimist, your positive outlook may be reaching its limits. But there is a difference between optimism and Christian hope. You see, optimism, it's a passive attitude. It's an expectation that things will get better eventually. And it's okay to ignore the facts for now and just try to feel good anyway. It's almost kind of like a mind over matter approach. But hope, especially Christian hope, is a far more powerful virtue. In Paul's letter to the Romans, he sheds light on the concept of hope that can serve as a powerful reminder for you and I. It comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Let's read it together. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. He starts off by saying, because of the grace that we have been given freely, not only can we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God, but we can also boast in our sufferings. Now, this must have come to a shock to the people reading it. Because in that time, if you were going through a period of suffering, it was looked at as God punishing you for doing something wrong. And this was true for the religions at that time and true for those who had converted to Christianity. Many believed that once you converted and accepted Jesus into your life, that you would not see any more suffering. But Paul turns this thought process on its head. He says that suffering is a natural part of the Christian experience. But he says that even out of suffering, something good can come. Now, he's not saying that God is causing that suffering, or that suffering for the sake of suffering is a good thing. God does not want to see creation suffer. But Paul doesn't have his head in the sand either. He knows that we live in a broken world. He knows that bad things happen to good people. He knows that life sometimes just doesn't seem fair. But he tells us that even in the midst of this suffering, there is a choice we can make. We can give up, give into despair and hostility, crawl into a hole and never come out, begin to believe that God doesn't care about us or what is going on in the world, or we can choose another route to see suffering for what it is and see it as an opportunity to grow. He says that suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And meditating on this passage, I began to realize that some of the most hopeful people I have ever met are the ones who have been through a lot in life. Even within our own congregation, I have heard so many stories that you have shared with me. Stories of painful loss. How some of you survived events like the Great Depression and many wars. I've heard stories of people who housed Jewish refugees during World War II at great risk. I know some of you have started ministries and foundations spurred from a tragedy you faced in life. And for those of you who chose to persevere through these dark times, even with all the pain that came along with it, it didn't seem to decrease your sense of hope, but it seemed to increase it. You see, hope that isn't tested isn't true hope at all. So I want to ask you a question. Do you feel stuck right now? One of the things I remember from physics class is the concept of inertia, that an object in motion stays in motion unless it is moved by an external force. or that an object at rest stays at rest. It tends to do nothing or remain unchanged. That's true for objects like this pulpit and your dining table. And it's also often true for human lives. I think it's amazing how many of us are content staying in misery in the name of not having to move. But often that's the difference between someone who lives with hope and someone who doesn't. But we tend to throw the word hope around a lot. We hope for good weather or for something good to happen. We almost use that word even passively. And if it doesn't happen, oh well, that's the way life goes. But the biblical concept of hope is much more profound than that. Hope, in this passage we read earlier, is translated from the Greek word elpis, meaning a strong and active expectation. Very similar to trust. And this makes hope an active virtue. If you have a strong anticipation that something will happen, you will make preparations for it to happen. It is an active conviction that doesn't ignore the facts, but confronts them. It tells us that something is worth doing, not just because it may turn out a certain way, but because it is good and right. That something is worth doing, not just because we may see results in the immediate future, but because it points us in the right direction. It orients our hearts to the source of hope, and it propels us forward. And that last verse tells us that this hope will not disappoint. Hope will not disappoint. Why? Because God's love will not disappoint. That same verse tells us that God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. We can hope because we know we are deeply loved by God and that we are never alone. You see, the source and the instrument of hope is love. Looking at these pictures on Father's Day just reminds me of the love between a parent and a child. My children know that I love them, so they have hope for the future, knowing that I will take care of them. The same is true with our relationship with God. If we know that God loves us, then we will always have hope, no matter what is going on around us. And I often think about all those people who are living without hope, because as a society, we haven't shown them love. We often look down on people who don't seem to have it all together, those who have been marginalized their whole lives, and we say, well, why can't they pull themselves up by their bootstraps and carry forward? We don't think that, one, they may not have the same opportunities that we have, but we also don't think about the fact that maybe the reason they are hopeless is because for too long they have been loveless, discarded by society, treated like second-class citizens for generations. You see, love and hope, they go hand in hand. And as Christians, we have this unique call to provide people with that sense of hope by understanding their sufferings and showering them with love. Hope says that God has not abandoned us in this world, that God still pursues us, intervenes for us, and will not forget us. And although there will be tears in our eyes, God will wipe them away. There will be death and decay, but God will cause newness and resurrection to spring forth. There will be evil and suffering, but God's love will carry us through. Because biblical hope isn't anchored in our circumstances. It is anchored in the person of Jesus Christ. I remember the first fishing trip I ever went on. It wasn't a great experience for me. Now, I had gone fishing plenty of times before that, but normally it was from a deck or from land, casting it into the lake. But my dad and mom took me out into the boat to fish for the first time. And I've never been a huge fan of large bodies of water. I figured that's the reason I don't have gills, is because I'm not supposed to be out here. But I remember when I first got on and stood up and cast my rod, I couldn't really focus on fishing because all I realized was I looked around and I saw the shore pretty far away. And with my rod and casting it into the lake, I remember seeing just the waves that were going through, and that's all I could focus on. And I remember my dad looked over at me, and he said, "It doesn't seem like you're having very much fun right now." And I said, "Well, it's hard to focus on fishing because all I can pay attention to is the fact that we are stranded out here, and all I see are these waves, and it seems like it's taken us farther away from the shore." And he said, "Don't worry. I remember to put the anchor down before we started fishing. So enjoy and concentrate on fishing. Because with this anchor, the boat will never be too far away." Biblical hope isn't anchored in our circumstances. It is anchored in the person of Christ. It is anchored in the salvation that was brought through Christ's suffering on the cross and the reality of the resurrection. We don't have hope in things. We have hope in someone. The Alpha, the Omega, the Ancient of Days, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Maker of heaven and earth, who we know is still at work in us and through us, regardless of our circumstances or situations. And when you have a strong and active anticipation, a solid trust in the person of Christ, and when you live a life anchored to Christ, you'll be able to take risks in life, knowing that those risks are worthwhile. You'll be able to weather any storm because you'll see God's love in the midst of it. And that hope, that trust, that anchor, that focus on God will never disappoint you. With today being Father's Day, it's a difficult one for me, with my father just having passed away less than a month ago. And this last month, his last month on earth, was a difficult one for me. He was in the hospital, and we weren't able to see him. And the whole time, it was just a roller coaster of emotions, because I was so sure that he was going to get out of there. And there were days when it seemed like that might be a possibility, and others when it seemed like it was going to be a complete long shot. And at the end, things didn't turn out the way I hoped they would. And I know that my dad had days when he was really sad with the way things were going. But not too long after he passed, we were able to speak to his pulmonary therapist, who was with him during his last few days. And she said that towards the end, she had never seen someone so at peace with dying. Because at the end of the day, his hope wasn't in his circumstances or situations, but in the person of Jesus Christ. The therapist then told us that witnessing his last moments gave her hope and meaning. That, my friends, is the power of Christian hope. A hope that can not only sustain us through suffering, but also be a witness to God's work in the world. A world that is in such desperate need of hope right now. An active hope that not only sustains us, but gives us the power to point others to its source. And that hope anchored in Jesus Christ, will never disappoint us. Let's pray. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for your presence in our lives. that even though we didn't deserve it, Jesus, you provided us with salvation and redemption. You gave us a glimpse into a moral, hopeful future through his life, his death, and resurrection. One that allows us to confront the evils in our society and often in our hearts, because we know your goodness will sustain us. So we give you thanks for your love and grace that fuels our hope, a hope that will never disappoint us. So we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ, a sure and steady anchor through the floods of unbelief. Hopeless somehow, oh my soul, now lift your eyes to Calvary. This my ballast of assurance, see his love forever proved. See, we'll hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be removed. Christ, the sure and steady anchor, as we face the wave of death, when these trials give way to glory, as we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind and life secure. And the calm will be the better for the storms that we endure. Christ, the shore of our salvation, ever faithful, ever true, we will hold fast to the anchor, it shall never be removed.
Amen. Christ, the sure and steady anchor. So in the words of the Apostle Paul, may the God of all hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. So go forth in that hope. Amen.